I'd like to thank ORDI organizers for this webinar and specifically Dipanjana, who's taken the effort to invite me. I'd like to thank all the people who have joined the webinar in this difficult time of COVID, where we are housebound and keeping social distancing. So my presentation is on epilepsy management in children from the parents' perspective. This is the most important thing about the presentation. It's not to doctors, but it's to parents and maybe to teachers as well. Other people who look after children who might have epilepsy. So the other title might have been Seizures and Epilepsy: What the Parents and Teachers Should Know. Starting with a dramatic observation, you learn how long 30 seconds really is when you are watching your child having a seizure. Any parent whose child is seizing in front of him or her can feel how long the seizure is going on for, although it might have been only 30 seconds. Otherwise, half a minute of time is nothing in our lives. Now, if you can look at the list below, these are the names of nine well-known people, writers, athletes, entertainers, and more, who lived with a seizure disorder at one point in their life or the other. And you have famous painters, you have poets, composers, writers, American president, entertainers, sportsperson, the last two. So there's a lot of people who have been affected with seizure disorder or epilepsy. But what you can also note is that all of these names are from the West. You look at the internet in India and type in Indian celebrities who have had seizure disorder or epilepsy. This is what will come out. Can we mute the other people, please? So here's a list of Indian celebrities. When you type in for epilepsy or seizure disorder, the finding comes out as who battled for mental disorders and came out like a rock star. And then there's a lot of these Bollywood stars who have apparently had mental disorders, most likely depression at one point or the other, and have come out of it with flying colors. Very good. But if you want to look at, no, I'm looking for Indian celebrities who've lived with epilepsy at some point in their life. Well, there's no list, there's no names. So what does that mean? That means epilepsy has a severe stigma attached to it, even in the 2020 year. So my presentation is going to try and tell you more to educate all of us about it so that we can get rid of the myths and stigma. And this is how I'm going to go about it. I'll try and define for you what seizures and epilepsy is. Try and talk about seizures happening in the school-going children and infants. What are different myths and how we can resolve them? What to do when a child is having a seizure, and overall trying to improve the quality of life. So what are seizures? Different names like fits, convulsions, in our local language, mirgi, torka, are terms that are used. Now, the commonest type of seizure is where you have an abnormal involuntary movement of one or more body part. It may be the face, the limbs, hands or feet, etc. And this may happen with or without loss of consciousness. So in certain types of seizures, you actually may be partly conscious. And what is it? It is actually a sudden surge of abnormal electrical activity in the brain that usually affects how a person feels or acts for a short time. So it's just like as if lightning has struck at one particular part. That sort of a feeling the person is going to have. So there's a disturbance in brain electrical activity, which gives rise to some abnormal movements, meaning motor movements, or it may also give rise to some abnormal sensations, like you can have a sense of some abnormal vision or hearing or even taste, and abnormal autonomic symptoms. This means heart rate, blood pressure can go up or down, and you can have increased sweating. These are autonomic symptoms that happen during the seizures. So then what is epilepsy? Well, epilepsy is a disorder characterized by recurring seizures. It is also known as seizure disorder. And epilepsy and seizures are not the same. Seizure is a symptom of epilepsy, and epilepsy is a disorder. So what happens in epilepsy? There is a temporary disturbance in the electrical activity of the brain, and it is not a psychological disorder or a disease. It is a neurological disorder, an electrical activity problem. And a very important thing, it is not a contagious disease. So just because somebody has epilepsy, that doesn't mean that the next person will also start having epilepsy. So this is a cartoon of the brain. As you can see, there are different parts. This side is the anterior part, or called the frontal part or frontal lobe. And this is called the occipital lobe. And this part is temporal. And here you can have the parietal and central parts. And then here you have the cerebellum and the brainstem. Each of these parts have different functions. So if you have an abnormal electricity in a particular part, that particular function may get disturbed. So for example, this is the occipital lobe, which is responsible for vision. So if you have a problem there in the electricity, then your vision may become abnormal. This is the part which deals with speech. And again, here, if you have an abnormality, you may not be able to speak. Now, epilepsy is basically of two types. One is called the focal, and that means the onset of the abnormal electricity happens in one particular part of the brain. The other one is called generalized, which means that it may have been an onset at a particular part of the brain, but the spread is so rapid that when we are actually looking at the seizure, it doesn't appear that it started off from a particular part of the brain, or if it did, we might have missed it. So then who has epilepsy? Well, over 70 million people in the world have epilepsy, and nearly 12 million people, that means 1.2 crores of people in India, are expected to have epilepsy. And we contribute to 1/6 of the global burden. What does that mean? Prevalence is about 1%. It is higher in rural and lesser in urban population. And about 50% of people with epilepsy have had their first seizure by the age of 25. Although epilepsy can happen at any age. What are the common causes? In 50%, we do not know the cause. So previously it used to be called idiopathic, cause unknown. But now we are finding that in this group, many more are found to be genetic causes, meaning there's some problem in the genes that is causing the epilepsy. And in the remaining 50%, there's a common cause that can be identified, like head trauma, brain or hereditary cause, perineal disturbance in brain development. So you can have neurological infections. Stroke is less common in children, but common in elderly. Head injury can happen in any age. Genetic causes, brain tumors, which not only may be malignant, but can also be benign. And then some problem or damage to the brain during the birth process, either when the child was in the womb or during the delivery process or soon after. And like I said, 50% may be unknown or idiopathic. What are the triggers? Most important trigger is if you've missed your medication, if you've lost sleep, or you're suffering from extreme fatigue. But other triggers like stress, anxiety, hormonal changes, dehydration, photosensitivity can all give rise to seizures. And in older persons, drug abuse, alcohol abuse, and so on. And even sometimes certain drug interactions, using medications, multiple medicines for different ailments, that can also, the drug interaction can give rise to seizures. Now, epilepsy is one of the commonest serious neurological disorders in children. And 50% of the epilepsies are onset in childhood. There is higher burden in developing countries because here we get more brain infections, higher birth-related problems, and more head injuries. And sometimes there's a huge treatment gap of up to 90%. That means only 10% of our children are actually being treated by doctors. There are also hidden short-term and long-term impact of epilepsy. And on the right, you can see that in the lifetime, 1 in 20, that means 5% of children are affected by a seizure or epilepsy. So how does epilepsy affect a child? It affects children at different ages and in different ways. In the early, recognition and treatment are keys to the best possible outcome. For some of the children, it may be a temporary problem, which is easily controlled with medications, and the medications can be stopped after a few years. But for some other children, it may be a lifelong challenge affecting many areas of life. Now, epilepsy can affect people in different ways. Why is this? Because there are many causes and different kinds of seizures. It's not just one seizure or one epilepsy. It's many different types of epilepsies. Some people may have multiple types of seizures in the same type of epilepsy, or other medical conditions in addition to the epilepsy, which may affect the person's lifestyle. Now, some of the seizures are hard to tell when a person is having a seizure. It may be so subtle. A person having a seizure may seem confused or look like they are staring at something that isn't there. At other times, it's quite obvious by a person suddenly having a fall, shaking, and becoming unaware of what is going on around them. Absence seizures is something that I will just briefly touch upon. It is a seizure where you have a sudden behavioral arrest or a blank episode, and discontinuation of your activity with loss of awareness, responsiveness, and memory. You have a staring look or a blank spell and an equally abrupt recovery, which lasts only for 5 to 30 seconds and can happen multiple times a day. So this is something that is seen in school-going children, and that's why I want to focus it. So you need to be aware about it. And therefore, for a teacher who is teaching in class, you need to be aware about children who might be having daydreaming episodes more often than not, or brief periods of loss of responsiveness, vacant staring. They may also have a recent drop in school performance or very poor concentration and attention in class. Now, I'm not saying that all children with such things will have epilepsy, but I'm trying to say that if a child is having any of these, you need to think about whether this could be a manifestation of epilepsy and make the appropriate referral. Now, coming to the facts and myths about epilepsy. Now, one common myth is children with epilepsy are often mentally challenged and poor studies. Is it true? Is it a fact or a myth? Because overall, intellectual ability is at par in children with epilepsy and other normal children. Now, some of the children are at greater risk for learning problems and academic underachievement, particularly if they are having ongoing seizures. And sometimes even in those with normal intelligence, there may be specific areas of deficits relating to certain aspects like attention, concentration, memory, organizational skills, and academic achievement. But in a lot of our children, their intelligence is at par with other children. Children with epilepsy are hyperactive, aggressive, and difficult to manage in school. This is also a myth. It doesn't mean that just because You have epilepsy, you expect the child to be hyperactive, aggressive, and difficult to manage. 90% or even more than that of children who have epilepsy have normal behavior at school. And there are also a lot of other kinds of problems where you can have these hyperactivity in a child without having epilepsy. Third, child with epilepsy must take medications lifelong. No, this is a myth. Why? Because in about 3/4 of the children, you can stop the medication after being seizure free for 2 to 3 years. And only in 1/4, 25 to 30%, do we have what we call drug resistant epilepsy. That means the medications are going on, but the child is having seizures. And only in 5% of children, there may be requirement for lifelong treatment. So in 3/4 children, it's only a matter of 3 years, let's say. In another 20%, they may be doing well on medicines, and that may be stopped beyond 3 years or after some other types of treatment done. And only in 5%, lifelong treatment is required. Kids with epilepsy will be a bad influence on other kids in the class. No, this is a myth. Now, what is the social and psychological impact of epilepsy? The social engagement with peers becomes difficult. The children are often excluded from full participation in academic, recreational, and social activities, and therefore suffer from social isolation, bullying, and teasing, and therefore have inadequate social skills and poor self-esteem. So the stigma associated with epilepsy and the insensitivity of others are also stresses that affect the emotion and adaptive behavioral responses in this children. And this is what needs to be got rid of. Children with epilepsy should not participate in outdoor activities like football, cricket, cycling, swimming. No, this is again a myth. We should try and include all activities for such children. The only activities that might need supervision is, for example, swimming and cycling, and maybe a few activities like, if you have it in your school, that is horse riding or rope climbing, those might have to be avoided. But any other activity that is on plain surface, outdoors or indoors, a child can take part. So again, going through this graph, epilepsy is not a rare disease. It is a common condition. Sometimes people think that during these episodes, you may swallow your tongue. It is impossible to swallow your tongue. Is epilepsy contagious? It is not contagious. Shaking and jerking is a part of epilepsy always. Well, no. It is not always that a person will be shaking and jerking. Like I told you, in absence epilepsy, you may just have a blank spell. Restraining somebody having a seizure. No, you should not restrain. On the other hand, there will be some first aid to prevent injury that I'll go through. Forcing something into the mouth while having a seizure, like a spoon. No, nothing should be put inside the mouth. The child should not be given something to drink. They should be put in the recovery position and something under the head. I'll come to this later. So epilepsy is not rare. We should not force anything inside the mouth of the patient. We should not restrain. And all epilepsies are not associated with shaking and jerking. It may be associated with things like blank episodes, abnormal behavior. But yes, the most common type of epilepsy, which is called the tonic-clonic seizure, is where a child becomes unconscious and has shaking or jerking movements. You cannot swallow your tongue in epilepsy, so don't try and pull the tongue out. It is not a contagious disease. It doesn't happen only in children. You can get it in any age of life. right from newborn period to 100 years old. And people with epilepsy are not disabled or cannot work. A lot of people with epilepsy are able to perform normal work habits and are successful and productive citizens of their respective countries. A common question that we are asked, can my child go to school like other children? Yes, of course they can. The child can attend regular schools and should be allowed to take part in almost all regular school activities, including sports that I mentioned. The school authorities ideally should be informed about the child's condition, but sometimes what happens, unfortunately, in our country and city is that some of the schools are not cooperative about all of this. They are not aware about it, misinformed, and therefore they do not want to know. So parents should take a call. And school teachers should be more aware of what to do in a case of a child who has epilepsy or seizure in school. Why? Because for every 100 children attending school, there is one child who has epilepsy. And so that child may have a seizure. So it is the responsibility of the school teacher or the authorities to understand a bit about epilepsy medication. Now, one thing I would like to talk about is slightly outside, but there's an entity called fainting or syncope, which is a closed differential diagnosis of epilepsy. We call it giddiness or fainting, or in Hindi, chakkar. Most commonly happens in the standing position, where a child, after prolonged standing at one place, like in an assembly or in a sports drill, the child has a sudden blackout or chakkar, falls down slowly. Prior to that, may have a pale look or excessive sweating. After falling down, they are quick to recover in a few seconds to minutes, and they are okay. Now, this is a cardiac or a brain event which causes a transient decrease in the oxygen and blood supply of the brain because of the surroundings, which is quick to recover as soon as the child. How to prevent syncope? The child needs to be hydrated appropriately, particularly in the summer months. Also, you need to give electrolyte water, not just plain water. To avoid prolonged standing, especially in hot sun, to avoid sudden changes in posture, like quickly from supine to standing position. And sometimes it also can, and these need to be checked out. Okay, now coming to management of seizures. Whether the child is at school or at home, the first few things to do for a seizure is remove or loosen tight clothing. Make the child lie down in a safe place to prevent further injuries from sharp objects or falls. Make sure the child's mouth is clear. So if the child is having a meal from the outside, try and get out as much of the food as you can. Check whether the child is breathing or not. And after the seizures have stopped, put the child in the recovery position, which I'll show you. And this is the commonest medication we are using nowadays for school or home administration or community administration of seizures. It is intranasal midazolam. So this is a spray that is given inside the nose. And this is widely available in the market. As you can see, if you hold it like a in that particular and push from the bottom, you can see a spray coming out of the nozzle, and that needs to be put directly into the nostril, like so. So the child needs to be sitting or in semi-reclining position, not lying flat, because this particular medicine needs to be not upside, partly erect posture. and you put it in one nostril and then the other nostril, and you gently pinch the nose. And the doctor will tell you how many sprays you need to give. That is going to come from the doctor's prescription. So in the sitting or semi-reclined, semi-reclined position, you administer the dosage in each of the nostrils with slight pinching of the nose in between until you've completed the dose. And then you put the child in the recovery position. What does that mean? Like this child is showing you, you are on one side, turned around as if you are hugging your pillow and sleeping. This sort of a position. This is the best position. This is called the recovery position. The one on the extreme right of your screen. So how to respond to seizures? What are the first aid and major tips? What we should do if somebody is having an epileptic seizure? Stay calm. Don't be tense. Look around. If it's a dangerous place, move them to a safe place. Move any objects or furniture. Try to look at the time and try and stay with the child. If they do not collapse but seem blank or confused, gently guide them away from danger and speak to them quietly and calmly. If they have lost consciousness, put something soft and flat under their head. Don't restrain them. Don't open their mouth or put anything inside them. Just simply make them lie down and clean any saliva that is coming out from the mouth, from the outside. Try and take a check of the time. Stay with them until they are fully recovered. Put them into the recovery position. But if the seizure is continuing for more than 5 minutes, then you need to call for help, check their airway, and even call for an ambulance. So what is the social impact in childhood? Well, this is the most important thing. It is often severe, producing isolation and loss of self-esteem in this children. So you should be frank with your children as parents about their epilepsy. Talk openly and honestly to a child about epilepsy and encourage the children to ask questions. The key message is people with epilepsy deserve respect and understanding, not teasing and cruelty. In my practice, I found a lot of parents actually trying to hide the whole disease from the child. Even if he's reasonably grown up, they will say, can I send him out when we discuss the history? Can you not discuss anything in front of him? Things like that I've got told. And usually I comply to the parents' request at that time, but later on the education starts that you cannot hide it from the children. So how to support your child? Sometimes listen, that is the best form of support. Parents know that growing up is tough for any teen, but teenage children with epilepsy, there's more anxiety and confusion. So parents have to play an important role in preventing this. The children, the teen, to be taught how to take care of them, give them protected lives. Don't do this, don't do that, don't go out. They need to be understanding themselves what or they shouldn't do, and regularly talk to them about their feelings and about their support. So these are points. Emphasize positive and praise them. Built on things your child likes to do. Avoid describing your child's seizures or the financial burden or medical care as problems in front of the child. Try and encourage a special hobby or a special skill that they have. Discuss the seizures and epilepsy openly and try. Child to be like any other child, to be active. try not to make your child seizures a reason not to do things the family would otherwise do. So the whole family's activities should be as much normal as possible. We are not going to go out, we are not going to go for a vacation, we are not going to go near the sea. These are not to be done. And take some time for yourself without feeling guilty about it. Now, coming to infants, or sometimes what happens, the family is faced with a newborn infant. So a new child is a bundle of anticipation and expectation. And any illness that a child may have, including seizures, may be terrible for the parents and family. But the important thing is that usually seizures in the newborn subside quickly, sometimes may recur and even continue to adulthood. The greatest challenge for a parent of a newborn with seizures is fear of the unknown. Well, if a doctor can understand the cause of the seizures, they can actions on the child's development, on the child seizure control. But even if they cannot find the exact underlying cause, that baby can have an excellent chance of having seizure freedom and developing normally. So what about teens? Teens and their parents should share the highs and lows of the often stormy period when the children become adults. Children whose intelligence is at least near average and whose epilepsy is well controlled can achieve independence during adolescence and adulthood in a large number of cases. You need patience and understanding for these children. And sometimes well-meaning parents may be over-predictive for their children and teens, but you need to understand how to let go and let them take care of themselves partly. So learning to live with epilepsy for a child is also, particularly a teenager, is also an educational process. Learning about their epilepsy so they can make appropriate lifestyle choices, because you are not going to be there with them all the time. I have had children who have had epilepsy, have gone on to go to boarding school, engineering colleges, and now are actually working in private companies, government sector companies, and are having independent lives, although their parents are still quite protective. But the children, now adults actually, are doing very, very well independently. So manage the seizures and daily living issues, living their life fully while navigating or adapting to safety precautions, lifestyle modifications, and the impact of epilepsy on their social, educational, and emotional lives is important. So you need to understand that about 1 out of 10 people may have a seizure during his or her lifetime. That means epilepsy or seizures are very common. And someday you actually may need to help somebody who is having a seizure. So like I said before, you need to stay with the person until the seizure ends or is fully awake. Shift the person to a safe place. Comfort the person and speak calmly. Loosen the clothing, but keep yourself calm. This is the most important part. So I've finished the most important parts, and now I'm going to talk a bit on other sort of, for this session, unimportant parts, but relevant parts, of course. These are the medical issues. Sometimes you will have come across these issues, so I just want to. So there are two important tests that we do in the diagnosis and management of epilepsy. One is called the EEG, or the electroencephalogram, and the other is called, you might have heard, is called the MRI. So EEG in childhood epilepsy is necessary for the diagnosis of epilepsy and sometimes helps doctors for classification of the seizures or the epileptic syndromes, trying to establish etiology, deciding which medications to give and when to withdraw medications, and even when to do surgery, if at all. So the common role for indications of epilepsy is of EEG is mainly in seizures, but sometimes when you are unsure about the loss of consciousness, like in syncope, you may have to do it. But EEG is not part of the workup in headaches or behavior problems or dizziness most of the time. So these are things that we should be wary about when EEGs are being requisitioned for these bottom highlighted disorders. This is a typical EEG graph, and on the red you see a sort of very high sort of thorny or projection, like a spike as we call it, that is coming on one half of this graph, mainly on the right, which is the red, which is the right side of the brain, but also from the left. And this is called the video EEG, where a child, there's a video camera focusing on him and having the EEG at the same time. So this is what we most commonly do now, video EEG record. What about MRI and neuroimaging? This is also very important, particularly where you have seizures, or you have a child with associated developmental delay, refractory seizures, bad sort of EEGs, early infancy epilepsy onset. And this is just one example of what you can get on an MRI. You have here these spots that you can see, and this, as soon as you see them on the MRI and CT, it is quite obvious that this is a diagnosis of tuberous sclerosis. And this is a condition where children can have some spots on their skin and also have epilepsy. Just an example. So coming to the medications now. Now this is the remit for the doctors, but I just want to mention it. There are certain medications that we use as priority depending on the type of epilepsy. And these are some of the names you might have heard. There are other medications that when you have focal epilepsy, when the epilepsy is coming from one part of the brain, then there are certain other medications to use. And we try and combine. Can I have some silence? Can the other people be muted, please? Sometimes when we have to use a combination of medications, we look at different mechanisms of actions that different medications may have and try to put medications of different types of mechanisms so that the overall effect is better. So these are all the newer types of anti-epileptic medications, but having said that, these are again 20 years old. Sometimes what happens is whenever you have given all the medications you can think about, in the 6 months, you're still not getting a response. These are where the medication isn't helps for the heart, as you know, for old people with cardiac problems. But like another pacemaker that is put on a nerve, which is about in the middle of your neck, called the vagus nerve. And sometimes just by using this stimulus, it has found that at least in 1/3 of the patients, there is a dramatic improvement in the seizure incidence. But usually this is a treatment for older children or adult population. Maybe a teenager could have a VNS, but not a younger child. And thirdly, epilepsy surgery. Yes, we need to consider epilepsy surgery where the seizures are medically intractable or the seizures are debilitating. Unfortunately, the scope for surgery or the number of centers carrying out this surgery are very few, and particularly in eastern India are very, very less. In some other metros like Delhi, Mumbai, Pune, Bangalore, Vellore, Chennai, there may be more centers. But in Calcutta and the eastern part, they are not that many. While you are trying to get epilepsy surgery workup, you may think about doing the ketogenic diet in the children. But again, a ketogenic diet, like I mentioned, needs a very, very thorough evaluation. And the main focus of this diet is a good dietitian. Now, sometimes we don't have dietitians to support us, and therefore we are not able to go about the ketogenic diet. So these are a few examples of how epilepsy surgery can be done. They try and look at a particular focal part of the brain which is causing the seizure and take that part of the brain out so as to try and get the person seizure free. So last couple of slides, what is the take home message? That epilepsy is not a disease, it's actually a disorder. But there are several different types, so you cannot lump all of it into one particular disease or disorder. Dispel the myths about epilepsy, that is what I've been trying to show you different examples about. Most of the children with epilepsy can have near normal lifestyle activities and inclusive education. And what we need to do as parents, as carers, as teachers, is to increase the positive attitudes and behavior so that these children with epilepsy feel comfortable around everywhere they go. So there's a responsibility for the family, friends, teachers, colleagues, employers, and society as at large for the particular person, child, adolescent, adult, that they should understand that a person with epilepsy can be just as reliable and as smart as someone without epilepsy, as I have shown in the slide, which contains so many celebrities, right from a president of the United States to cricketers, to sprinters, to educationists, poets, everybody was able to have a very good sort of lifestyle. And by educating yourself, you can therefore educate others about the myths and reality in epilepsy. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful and brilliant presentation. I'm sure every parent who has heard this, it will be useful to the parents. We have few questions here, and specifically a few questions from the Rett syndrome patient advocacy group. Sameer ji asks, how can a parent distinguish between an epileptic and non-epileptic seizure?
Even the doctors are sometimes very confused between the two. So it's not at all easy. The gold standard is, from the parent's perspective, taking as many home videos as you can and showing them to your doctor. And the doctor, of course, means a person who understands epilepsy what a seizure is and non-epileptic event is. And after assessing everything, if we feel that there are certain events that we are unsure of, then to go ahead with not only a EEG, but a prolonged video EEG record, where you may capture certain of these events and see whether the EEG at the same time is either showing some abnormality or is showing normalcy. And particularly with Rett syndrome, because these children do have a lot of stereotypies, they can also have some blank episodes, vacant stares. So it is difficult to sometimes differentiate. The important thing is that we, of course, would not treat the non-epileptic events with anti-epileptics, and we don't need to jump into early treatment of epileptic events when we are not sure. So even if we do not make a diagnosis of an epileptic event in the first day or the first week, it's better to wait and watch rather than make a sudden diagnosis when you're not sure and put a child on the medication. This is my personal view, because that medication will have to go on for several years.
Sir, we have a few questions on what are the side effects of the AED, of AEDs, and whether some certain tests should be done periodically for a child who is on an AED.
Right. Yes. So, unfortunately, any medication has side effects. Even simple painkillers like paracetamol, if you look at the web and look at the side effects, you'll see a of side effects written down. But what we need to understand is the common side effects as well as the ones that might be dangerous. So each of the anti-epileptic medications do have such a set, and it is the duty of the doctor who is starting the medication to actually, in the first visit when they are starting the medication, talk about these common side effects. Now, it is impossible to talk about everything, but it is possible to spend at least 2 minutes talking about the common side effects and what needs to be done about those side effects. I'll just give you one example of the most common medication that is used, called sodium valproate. Now, sodium valproate has been around for nearly half a decade. It is a very good medication and is used in a lot of different types of epilepsies. But there needs to be caution. Number one, starting from right from the newborn period, if you are suspecting any metabolic problem, metabolic epilepsy, metabolic syndrome, we cannot give sodium valproate because that might be untoward. So we avoid it. Number two, in the first year or two of life, if you give sodium valproate, then the chances of hepatotoxicity, meaning liver damage, is higher, and therefore the you have to give it. I do also give it, but to be 10 times more careful in monitoring the child and the liver function tests than I am when I start a child who is 3 years and more in age with sodium valproate. Girl who is going to start puberty, menstruating, and later on going to perhaps think about a family. In these children, sodium valproate may give rise to hair loss, hair fall, problems with your menstrual cycles. It may give rise to some hirsutism and even infertility. So, in this age group, unless we are absolutely against the wall, we try and avoid starting an adolescent girl in the 10 plus bracket or 13 plus age group with sodium valproate. So this is, it's not just one particular set of side effect on of a medication. Even one medication between 0 to 20 years can have so many host of important things that you need to think along. That, of course, the parent needs to understand and know, but it is the doctor's responsibility to think about all of this at these particular ages when they are thinking about starting the medicine.
Sir, we have a very related question which actually discussed. So here the question is that does MENAR cause, that can be one of the triggers for epilepsy? I'll just rephrase it also. That's because it was asked from Sameer ji, who is advocating for the Rett syndrome parents group. But I'll rephrase it and I'll say that that's adolescence, because there's a hormone change in the body trigger epileptic conditions.
Yeah, there are certain types of epilepsy that come about in adolescence. And yes, hormonal changes may be triggers, but these are things you cannot do anything about. There's another type of epilepsy that is called the catamenial epilepsy. And that means the seizures becoming increased around the menstrual period. This can happen in women right from the teenage years to even much, much later on in life. And this has a specific treatment. So the background is that a woman with epilepsy is maybe doing quite well on a medication, but around about her periods, it may be 2 days prior to her period's onset, until the period lasts, the seizure frequently suddenly goes up. She may have a cluster, what we call a cluster of seizures happening. So in those particular types, we actually can support that period with an extra medicine so that it is taken care of. So for example, somebody who is having catamenial epilepsy that has been diagnosed, as soon as the person, the woman with epilepsy, understands she may be starting her next menstrual period, she starts this new medication that may go on for 5 days, 7 days, or 10 days until her periods are over. And then she stops the medication until her next menstrual cycle.
Sir, we have another question. Related to investigations, it says that how often should an EEG be done?
There is no routine set of how often should be done. There's nothing called a routine EEG, meaning just to check that a child is doing well. EEGs are part of the investigation to help you in the diagnosis. If I haven't mentioned it before, I'm mentioning it now. Epilepsy is a clinical diagnosis. You do not need an EEG or an MRI to make a diagnosis. What happens is, once you've made a diagnosis of epilepsy, which is clinical, then you have to think, would this be focal? Can it be generalized? Am I seeing a generalized epilepsy that might have started as a focal epilepsy? And therefore, could it be just affecting a part of the brain? And therefore, you need to do the investigations. So EEG helps in this process to differentiate between a focal and a generalized epilepsy, to differentiate different types of epilepsy syndromes. For example, in absence epilepsy, what happens is that the classical EEG is you ask the patient or the person to hyperventilate. So take deep breaths while doing the EEG, and suddenly the EEG will become very, very high amplitude until the person is hyperventilating and then goes off. So if you do that in a child with absence epilepsy, it's basically 1 + 1 = 2, and we've got a diagnosis. Other reasons for doing an epilepsy is when you're not getting response from your medication treatment. Sometimes when you have to work up the patient for epilepsy surgery, like we mentioned earlier, when you're unsure between epilepsy versus a non-epileptic event as the cause. And of course, after the treatment is nearly over, when you are thinking about stopping medicines, that time also, if you have a normal EEG, you feel much more sure about the process of reducing the medicines. So these are some of the indications, but there's nothing like routine EEG.
Sir, we have a question from Asha Naranji. She asked that if any kind of chromosomal aberration or metabolic disorder is associated with epileptic episodes in the child, how should that be handled? Basically, I guess what she means is, what if epilepsy is a part of other syndromes, and how can we sort of address such a child?
Yeah, so when it is part of a chromosomal anomaly, epilepsy is not the only manifestation that you need to understand. So it's part of a whole constellation of things, including, for example, the dysmorphisms, the developmental delay, intellectual disability, maybe associated speech, even cardiac, for example, in Down syndrome. So there's a lot of other things. So epilepsy shouldn't be treated just by itself in these children. You should take the whole picture, the whole child, and address individually all of it. And for this, sometimes you need a multidisciplinary team, because most of these children usually need developmental therapies of different kinds. So ideally, they should be under a team comprising of not only a pediatrician, which is the main, who is going to be the main person, but also a child developmental specialist, a pediatric neurologist, many therapists, physio, speech therapist, and also you should have a clear understanding of what the chromosomal anomaly is and the literature on that. For example, epilepsy and Down syndrome. So you should have an idea about how epilepsy happens. There's another common epilepsy that is happens in a condition called ring chromosome 20. So here you should read up the literature of what ring chromosome 20 and epilepsy means, not only in terms of just the epilepsy, but for the overall child, not particularly one symptom.
Sir, we have a question more in a behavior segment. It says, how to control the violent behavior in a teenage epileptic like child?
Yeah, so that doesn't mean that children without epilepsy don't have behavioral problems. So it should be addressed in a similar sort of way. There should be involvement of child and adolescent psychiatrists, psychologists, psychotherapists, counselors, special educators, school counselors. Those are the important people that come to mind. And also, as a pediatric neurologist perspective, what I'm going to look at is, are any of my medications or other medications causing this? Can they be aggravating the behavior? Because like we mentioned, the side effects of sodium valproate, they are medications that have side effects on behavior. And okay, if I have to give a medication which aggravates behavior for 3 days, 5 days, I may tell the parent, hey, listen, I'm giving this medicine for 5 days, during which time your child may be a bit hyper and angry. But after 5 days, as soon as I stop the medicine, it'll be okay. That is one issue. But if you say I'm going to give the medicine which may cause behavior problems long term, and it doesn't mean that it will cause, but it may cause, and that parent comes back and tells me, my child wasn't like this before. After putting him on this medicine, he has an abrupt change in his behavior from here to here. Then I have to listen. Just because the seizures are controlled and my medicine is working, I'm not going to say, oh, no, you have to deal with it. Seizures are controlled, everything is fine. You have to understand that maybe the medicine is causing this other side effect, and therefore deal with it. Think about alternatives. There are at least 20 drugs or medications. Give one, two, or three. There are at least another 5, 6, or 7 which we can use.
So we are almost at the end of the session, and we would be wrapping up. But I have quick one question. That is, Sir Arun Das Ji asks, what is the difference between spasm and seizures?
Spasm is a type of seizure. Just to very quickly tell you, seizures are different types. If they happen from one part of the body, like I'm moving my right hand, that's like a focal seizure. But when they happen on both sides, they can be of different types. The most common type where you shake both the hands together is called the tonic-clonic seizure. Likewise, you can have what is called an atonic seizure, where you suddenly lose tone and fall down. You can have a myoclonic seizure, where you have a sudden jerk and then go down. Similarly, there's something very peculiar called a spasm, which we call in our medical literature like a salaam attack, as if somebody is doing a salaam, meaning saluting somebody. So both of the hands go up and the neck is slightly flexed. So spasms are basically a type of generalized seizures that happens, and it is seen mostly in the first 2 years of life. And if you have spasms, then there are different types of epilepsy syndromes that are likely to cause, one of which is a syndrome called the West syndrome. The West syndrome is the particular type where you have spasms. So spasm is just one of many types of seizures that you can have, and it is usually in the generalized category, not a focal. However, you can also have a focal spasm.
Thank you so much, sir, for such a wonderful presentation and also such a wonderful interactive session. I thank Prasanna sir, Swami sir, for giving us this podium where this could be presented. And I, to sort of summarize the whole session, I would say what sir said is very important. We shouldn't stigmatize. There are definitely ways, and this shouldn't be one of the reasons why a child should be stigmatized. We should speak about it more. We should clarify it more. We should be able to ask questions, answer questions to the child. And sometimes if we are facing violent behaviors, or if the child has other problems, like if there are other syndromes present, then other people, other doctors, it should be a multidisciplinary approach to the child's treatment. And when we are talking about medications, it is definite that we should the clinician who is taking care, or the caregiver, should ask questions if he or she has one. And as far as the tests or the follow-ups, it should be a guided one. We should not do something on our own as parents, but we should definitely take the guidance of the clinician or the caregiver. If required, ask a number of questions, but not stigmatize the whole situation. With this, I thank you, sir, for your session, and thank everyone of you for joining and asking questions. And with this, I pass it on to Prasanna sir and Swami sir.
Yeah, I would like to thank again ORDI, Mr. Prasanna, Mr. Swami, and of course Dipanjana, for this nice webinar that was not for doctors but for parents. And I hope you do continue your good work in this aspect. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for your valuable time. I think it's just a beginning. Probably I look forward to more such information, because you know many people will not be able to attend all the sessions regularly. So I look forward and request your valuable time in future also. Probably more specific discussion kind of a thing, because many parents have a lot of questions. Although they keep asking their regular treating physician, but you know, in between they crop up and also would like to know from different people, which will give them kind of a solace to their, So I look forward to more such session, and your session was very wonderful, very, in a very convincing language, not doctor language, I would say. I hope the parents who have attended enjoyed it. Thanks so much for your time, sir.
Thank you very much.
All the participants who has taken time to attend this. Thanks, sir.
Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful session.
Thank you, sir.
So let's dissolve. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Dipanjana.
Thank you, sir.